So I guess I'm gonna start with some of the, you know, some of the kind of warm-up questions. Like, for instance, like, what inspired you to want to write the things that you do? Or who are some of the people that you looked up to, and what types of stories inspire you, you know, to start off with, just as a writer?
Hmm.
Or as a consumer of fiction or narratives of any kind, so.
You want me to take it?
You can go.
I'll just start. I can't help remembering this is January 15th. Mm-hmm. Martin Luther King Day, when my mother used to let us stay home from school before there was a holiday. My sisters and I could stay home from school. And their activist friends, black and white, would come to the house and they'd play old speeches and records. So my parents were really the first storytellers mm-hmm. in my life, those oral narratives about what they did, what their friends did, just to make sure that would not be forgotten. So those kinds of stories really spoke to me. The Diary of Anne Frank and Roots by Alex Haley. So I did little baby stories from the age of four, but I started to really write when I wrote my little ripoff of Roots called Lottie Lottie Make Us Free about a girl undergoing the Middle Passage. You know, I was really drawn to try to explain the inexplicable. How do people survive? And even the horror I write is about that. How do you survive against just this insurmountable thing, whether it's a demon or a zombie or a curse or whatever it is.
Mm-hmm. Wonderful.
That's great. Mm-hmm. I started writing Afrocentric. It was a response really to when I was teaching right over here actually at SF City College and Laney College in mm-hmm. Oakland. I was teaching a class on the prison industrial complex, and the only book that seemed to make it into my students' mind or home or whatever was The Real Cost of Prisons comic book. I don't know how many people have heard of that book, but it came out around 2007, 2008. And it's a comic book that explains the prison industrial complex in great detail, but also it really lays down some complex ideas just through illustrations and a little bit of writing. Mm-hmm. So I was heavily inspired by that, and I started to write my own comic book. I intended it originally to be a curriculum for my students, but it ended up being, you know, me kind of musing on the relationship between my brother and I, and how I, you know, became kind of like this black radical feminist growing up in the white suburbs, you know. So I loosely base a lot of the characters on myself, my brother, and it's also an amalgamation of people that I know. And then I was also really inspired by Aaron Magruder's The Boondocks. Big ups to The Boondocks. You know, it was the first time that I saw that you could introduce humor and also humor and wit, but also talk about real life things. Mm-hmm. And so that was a big inspiration for me with Afrocentric, and I took a lot of cues from that comic book.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. You know, I would even state that notion of signification of humor and various types of you know, storytelling, and as we know, story, the idea of a story is also kind of a lie to a certain degree. You know, that, you know, like you're telling a story, you know, that kind of thing. I always love that idea that you're using the story or the signification of something to really get at a deeper meaning or a deeper mm-hmm. truth, you know? And quite recently, I've been really fascinated by a lot of what Bruce Sterling calls a diegetic prototype. So this notion of, anybody know Bruce Sterling's work? He's a science fiction writer. He was one of the godfathers, or is one of the godfathers of cyberpunk, but he's also a design theorist too. And so this notion of like the diegetic prototype, the idea of taking a story, the kernel of a story, and making something that directly deals or signifies about something that is a social issue or something that you're dealing with in the quote-unquote real world, right?
Mm-hmm.
So one of the things when I was tasked with moderating this discussion, I was thinking about the connections. I was looking for the connections between the panelists. So one of the things, of course, is the fact that it seems to me, you know, just from looking at the work, that politics or certain types of politics drive the work, right? Or it's an underlying theme to a certain degree. And do you think as creators or that there's possible to not do something that's political, or is it something that's like, you know, I mean, is it possible for you to make something in that fashion? Because I know what my answer is, you know, but I'm like, you know, because talk about the intersection between your politics and the stories that you make, but also, do you make things that are just for the sake of making, you know, that kind of thing, or do you have to?
That's a tough question.
I know, right?
The way I look at it is if I'm writing a character of color, that's political.
Yes.
Even now,
yep.
Right?
Yep.
So it could be a story about a girl looking at a rainbow, you know, but still.
Yeah, what colors would she see?
I am.
Yeah,
I exist. Yeah. Writing historical fiction is so political. I'm sorry, because our society has worked so hard to erase us, mm-hmm. you know, even seeing ourselves and like fences. How often do you get to see that era in film, you know? So.
Talking about Hidden Fences? I'm sorry.
Boy, you about to have me thinking I said that.
I'm still angry. I'm still dealing with that a little bit. I'm sorry. Still dealing with it.
Okay. Get me started. So there's that, you know. I used to erase myself in my work as a young writer I don't know what happened after Lottie Lottie Make Us Free, but the more I was exposed to the canon, the more I vanished in my work. So by the time I was in college, I was writing white characters, you know, for no reason. Just mimicking. I had a little work to do.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, there was a political journey just to discover myself in my own work and to be okay writing about horror or the supernatural, you know, rather than, you know, as people said to Octavia Butler, why aren't you writing about the revolution? Not realizing she was writing
about
the revolution in her way, right? In her way. And that was my way. So sometimes it's more overt, like I'm writing a novel now that is very much about incarceration. It's set at a juvenile prison, basically. It's mm-hmm. a historical,
mm-hmm.
based on a real life family event. Hoping to use that to illustrate this wider problem that we have in our society right now. And then other times it's metaphorical, like my Living Blood series by the last novel. No, Blood Colony, the third one. We had lost Octavia then, and my question was, what might Octavia write now under this Bush administration? Which, you know, that was my question to myself, my secret prompt.
Right.
And I dedicated the book to her, and it was about the war on drugs, and how if there were a magic blood that could heal any ailment, would it be legal? Mm. No. Mm. Why would it not be legal?
Regulated.
Because of Big Pharma, you know, and this is where we are right now. And I used the term the new Jim Crow in that novel, one of the characters' father warning him not to get arrested selling this blood. So that was my way of trying to be more overtly political. But I think everything we do almost is political as artists.
With the consciousness I have right now, there is no way I could do anything that is not political. I already took the pill, so it's like, I can't go back now and be like, I just want to make something fun. Like, I feel like at this point, I feel somewhat a responsibility, but also I feel a responsibility to, you know, to kind of tell the truth, whatever that truth is for me. And you know, again, like I said, I started with the intention of wanting my comic book to be a curriculum. So when I first started to write it, it was dense, it was didactic, it was like, you know, I was using the characters to really speak to different kind of political ideologies. Over time, I've switched that up a little bit to try to make them more nuanced. But when I first started writing, it was like, you know, I wanted to have the character in there that was the black radical. I wanted the character in there that kind of represented Chicano nationalism. Mm-hmm. And it's still there to a large degree. But now it's one of the things that I've learned with writing is, you know, even like for me, I was trying to write these characters where I was like, oh, okay, this is like what this kind of person would think about. But one of the things that you end up having to do when you write is like, you need to humanize each character, even if you don't like them, even if you don't like their politics, or even if you don't like what they're doing. It's really important to humanize them. Otherwise, people will kind of see right through that,
mm-hmm.
And know that you're not being true, right? So, you know, for me, the first three volumes of Afrocentric have been about gentrification. For one, because I'm from the Bay Area, and it's the thing that's happening around me and I was trying to name it, and even gentrification didn't seem to fully encompass all the things that were, that was happening. So I used the things that were happening around me to kind of move the story. Mm. So it's a saga of how, you know, these college students try to stop gentrification, but because they're college students, they're also kind of, they're part of that problem, right? So, I try to make it humorous. So they start the first anti-gentrification social networking site in the world called mydiaspora.com. And it's basically supposed to be this home where people can stop gentrification on the web, right? Because, you know, I was thinking about like the kind of millennial sensibilities that we have around social justice now are very much tied to technology. Mm. So I wanted to put that in there and kind of joke with that a little bit. But I look at the things around me and I feel like now, especially as writers and artists, we really have a responsibility almost to just kind of, you know, not shy away from the things that are happening right now.
So. That's excellent, excellent. Speaking of not shying away from things, right? It's hard not to notice that you're both Black women, right?
So, what?
Yeah, I know. I'm like, what? Like, no, you are. Right? And so it's always very difficult, I think. I mean, in this, well, it's a hyper patriarchal space, right? All of industry, the creative fields, is still dominated greatly, I think, by a very hyper-patriarchal attitude, narrative, what have you. But then when you map the notion of race on top of that, you double down on the different types of struggles that you have to deal with, right? Mm. So could you speak, I mean, because I see there are a lot of women of color in the audience, and I'm sure that they would like to know some of the different, yep, mm-hmm. See? Was that, I'm sorry. Yes. So I'm sure that they would like to know a little bit about, not necessarily your struggle, but different types of ways that you've circumvented some of those attitudes, or are still utilizing ways or technologies even to circumvent those types of things, and what types of methods have you I think employed besides just like working very hard, you know? But
You know, as a novelist, mm-hmm. I was so blessed to come at a time where being a woman, I think, was an empowering thing as a writer. As a Black woman writer, mm-hmm. coming right after Terry McMillan's Waiting to Exhale, when publishing was like, oh, Black people read?
Right. Right.
Right. So my book was nothing like Waiting to Exhale, but it was a Black, commercially like a page turner. So they're like, well, let me see if it'll stick. I mean, there were a lot of people getting contracts and mm-hmm. hardcover paperback tours, all those book club meetings, 99.9% women. I remember being in Seattle with my husband, Stephen Barnes, and Charles Johnson at a Go On Girl book club event, and they were looking at the sea of Black women going, man, we don't have this. So that, I don't know now, for writers trying to break in, the industry has changed. You know, those contracts have dried up. The sisterhood is still there. I know the book clubs are still there. But that bubble burst mm-hmm. a little bit, and there probably is more individualism and scrabbling. Where I have more of an issue is in Hollywood. I've been trying to transition into screenwriting, mm-hmm. mm. and that is a very non-inclusive space. You know, I was just telling a friend of mine the story about how I drove all the way to Comic-Con and fought all that traffic to go to a meeting my manager invited me to, and it was just a sea of, you know, just very short-haired white males, much younger than I was, and there was no entree, you know, to a lot of conversation. I felt very much the outsider. I do better when women gather in their own spaces. And there are enough Black women in Hollywood right now where they can do that. They can have a party, you know, they can invite directors, producers, casting directors, you name it. And all of you just sit in the room and talk. And that's a much easier space for me. And luckily times are changing enough that I don't have to go to that Comic-Con party, you know, I could skip that party, right? And go to just the party where people know or care who I am, or know or care the stories that I would like to tell.
Yeah. You know, so part of me has been really inspired by, yes, the Black Panther getting Roxane Gay to do the writing and things like that. Wonderful. But I've also been really inspired by just seeing the trajectory of somebody like Issa Rae, right? Yes. And seeing that trajectory of going from throwing a video up on YouTube, yes, a web series, to that catching, you know, a lot of momentum and you know, doing a Kickstarter and things like that. I think that also, I don't know, I'm going to just mention this. I throw this out there. I just watched Chewing Gum on Netflix.
It's on my list. Yeah. I haven't seen it yet. Yeah, I want to see it.
I mean, it's so wild. Like, and part of me is like, oh my God, I can't believe they let a dark-skinned Black woman write and produce this entire TV thing. I mean, it's just like, it's so crazy to me that, you know, even growing up like in the 80s and 90s, I'm just like, I don't ever remember anything like that, right? Mm-hmm. Where she could be overtly sexual. And so I'm very happy that there are avenues that people can kind of find their way in. And a lot of times, really and truly, it comes from the support of Black folks, really and truly, mm-hmm, right? Mm-hmm. Of pushing these stories and these narratives and saying like, yo, we want this. Like, we're watching these shows. We're interested in what these folks are doing. So for me, it's been great to have a couple of different models, albeit not necessarily like in comics, yeah, right? But it's been great to have these models. And the other thing that I always think about is, like, you know, no one at Marvel is gonna write a story like Afrocentric, you know, which to me is an advantage, right? Mm-hmm. Because you don't have the mindset and you don't have the consciousness to write this story. You know, it just means that there's that many more stories that need to be told, right, that come from that's people right like me and that look like me. So
wonderful. Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Thank you. And thank you, seriously, yeah, for Afrocentric.
Thank you.
So before I open it up to the audience, because I don't want to chew up everything, I'm very process oriented. So could you? And how many writers in the audience who write?
Raise them up.
Yeah. Don't be ashamed. Yay. Okay.
Good.
Could you speak a little bit about plotting, writing, the craft a little bit, about how you start a story and finish it, and, you know, just the writing process a little bit?
It's changed for me a lot because I started out fresh and energetic and writing in my spare time as a newspaper reporter, just with this fever energy level, you know, which as I'm getting older, I don't feel that same feverish energy level. So my process has adapted, and here are the most important things, especially for busy people. I'm assuming none of y'all are full-time writers. so when you're not a full-time writer, one of the most difficult things is, quote, finding the time to write. Though if you think about how much TV you're watching, you probably do have enough time to write. It's a matter of making the time. Making the time to write.
Right.
I knew a reporter whose husband passed away suddenly at the age of 35 when she had just had their fifth child. And that was when she decided to write her novel. She needed to write it then, and she found a way to make it happen, okay? Mm-hmm. So, but I'm teaching now, I'm doing screenwriting, there's mm-hmm a lot competing with my prose right now, and often it's at the bottom of the stack because it doesn't have a deadline attached to it. So one of the tricks to keeping a project alive, because they can die, you've probably had some die. It happens. It happens even when you're published. You just never finish a story. You never finish that novel. It happens. So write a sentence a day if you can't do anything else. We have this idea that we need a two-hour block. Oh, those are great. But if you don't have a two-hour block and a closed door and complete silence, try to find those little cracks in your day. Just those little cracks. So I can work for 30 minutes, 15 minutes even if you just read over the last good paragraph you wrote and try to improve upon one of the sentences in that paragraph, just a sentence a day. And if you give yourself permission to let a successful writing day look a little different than you used to think a successful writing day was, you stop beating yourself up. Because we spend half our time criticizing ourselves for what we're not doing. Let's celebrate what we are doing and how much else we're doing in addition to that. And it will get done as long as you keep working on it.
Ooh, that is so true.
Wonderful. Yeah. You're like one of the nicest horror writers ever. Because you're still scary as hell.
I'm sorry.
I'm sorry.
Man, that's such a good point about, allowing yourself to the space to write and not criticize your writing. So like when you write and then you erase and then you write and you erase and you're just like, no, that's not good enough. I mean, my process has changed too. And again, I was coming kind of from academia, so the voice changed completely. Mm. And to be real, y'all, like, I didn't know what I was doing when I first wrote the comic book, and you'll see it transition, you'll see the voice change. But writing a comic book and now I'm writing a comic strip, a weekly comic strip, those are two different writing processes. Mm-hmm. So when it comes to writing the comic strip, oftentimes what I find myself doing is I'll get an idea, or like I'll have a conversation and I'll get an idea and I'll write it in my phone. And then I'll come back to it. I do a lot of writing on my phone, especially when it comes to like the subject matter with the comic strips, because I can write real quickly, like, you know, like Oakland turns to Oak Heights or whatever. I have this thing about gentrification and it changing, right? And the name's changing. So I'll just write that down, you know? And so when I come back to it, then it allows me like, okay, this is what I was going for. This is what I was thinking in that moment. For the comic strips, because they're so punchy, you know, it's only a few lines. That's right. So it's easier to come back and get that. But with the comic books, you know, I riff off of certain ideas, and I've read about other people's processes, but this is just mine, you know. I riff off of ideas or things that happen to me. So like with volume 4, I wrote, the story is the main character. She ends up getting an internship as a racial translator. So she translates black people to white people and white people to black people. And the joke kind of is that her boss is like, oh, well, yeah, you can do this because you're mixed. And her whole thing is like, well, any black person can do this because, you know, we know white people better than they know themselves, right? So I started writing that because of a conversation I had with a friend where I was at his bakery and I was like, yo, I can't hear you. And he's like, yo, do we need a translator? And I was like, oh my God, what if there was a racial translator, you know, to like pick up on all the nuances of communication. And so I riffed off of that idea and I thought it would be, you know, humorous enough, but also like, you know, I could still talk about All of the things. So that's how volume 4 got started. And I just took that little idea, like, what if Naima Pepper was a racial translator? And that's like what set off the story. So
one thing I'll add just to process in addition to the sentence a day, if you're struggling with a project, especially completion, mm-hmm. Well, first of all, start small. Maybe before your trilogy, write a short story or two.
Exactly. Yeah, the world.
Right? Oh, no. But then also outlining. That's something I've learned from screenwriting. Yes. Because you do not proceed without an outline in screenwriting for a lot of reasons. Oh, and I find it tremendously helpful, and I lean on them now. They're not written in stone. Your characters can throw it all away, maybe. But see it through. At least have a vision for how it will end, and that will help it end.
Oh, I have one more because you just made me think of something. One of the things that helped me actually write the second volume was when I had to go back to volume 1 and figure out how to market it, right? Because people were like, okay, well, you need something together like a character bio. You need to tell us what are these characters about? And I, like, real talk, I hadn't thought about it deeply. So I was like, okay, like, what are they motivated by, you know? And this was like, these are probably all the things you should have done before you started to write, but this was just my process because I was like, I'm just going to do this comic book and see what happens. But going back and actually marketing them helped me a great deal to figure out like what the next steps were for the next stories. So think about it, like, how are you going to pitch the story that you have to other people? Like, what is your book about, you know? Who are these characters? What is this world? Is this world mirroring this world right here? Or is it like this world, but there's a couple things that are different? Are the characters telling the truth about the world or not? So these were all things that I had to think about that I ended up thinking about after I wrote the first volume. So
awesome.
So yeah.
Oh, thank you so much. Before I open it up to the audience, I do want to take the time out. You guys have seen these images around, right? So these images are by a young black woman from New York. Her name is Julie Anderson. And she's amazing, right? And, we're recording this, right? We love you, Julie. Thank you so much for doing these images. She's amazing. Look her up. But I just want to give her a round of applause because she killed it. These are beautiful images.
Yeah, definitely.
So, questions? We have time for what? Three questions. Obi, sorry. Oh, I couldn't see.
Hello, my name is Obi, co-creator of Red Origins. Been following this black sci-fi process since 2012. And my main question, and it has to do a little bit with world building, because there seems to be a lack of world building, but what happened to the word Afrofuturism? It's not talked about as much anymore. A lot of people here are new and they haven't really heard about it. That's what people were talking about from 2012 up. So it seems like Afrofuturism is not as well talked about. So I would like to hear more of your discussion on that and what that means versus other stuff.
Funny you mentioned that. I am teaching for the third quarter now at UCLA a course called Afrofuturism. And a lot of my students who sign up for it day one have no idea what it is either. You know, the short answer would be, for those of you who aren't familiar with the term, I call it Afrofuturism and also Afrofantasy, you know, which is hand in hand with that, is where we insert ourselves in the future or in magical realms. A lot of it sometimes is utopianism, escapism. Some of it can be dystopia, like Octavia Butler's Parable series, to show us, you know, what's right around the corner or right in front of our door, or in the house.
Seriously.
But it's between literature, film, art, comics, music. No, they weren't all in collaboration. One of my students were like, well, was Miles Davis talking to Octavia? No, they were not in conversation except creatively, because this was an art rising to its times. You know, when Sun Ra says space is a place, that's because this is no longer the place, right? This is no longer, this is not a comfortable space. So but you know what's interesting about it is it's a term, and a lot of the early practitioners of so-called Afrofuturism would not have considered themselves. They didn't know. I mean, it was just coined in 1993.
That's right.
And it's used probably mostly in academic circles, I would say. I mean, I've heard from teachers of Afrofuturism in Germany, and I mean all over the world. So it's a growing academic sort of language, but I don't know that it's permanent, and I like it. I mean, as someone who doesn't write as much futurism, I like Afrofantasy too, but don't leave out the horror. But I think we represent Afrofuturism right here. So it's the creation of the work, it's teaching each other how to create the work, and presenting a future that all of us, you know, can either march toward or away from together as we create those images.
Just to kind of piggyback off of that, I think, as Tananarive said, that the term generates from like the technoculture from the 1990s, right? But the term is actually created by a white scholar named Mark Derry. Yeah. And I think that of recent years, I think a lot of people have started to assign that to a kind of Columbusing to a certain degree, you know? And so there's been, I think, kind of a reaction to it, creating different spaces by people of color, so renaming it or rethinking it. There's been other pieces like Astro-Blackness, the Ethno-Gothic, you know, the Ethno-Surreal, the Afro-Surreal, different types of coinages that actually are being generated by people of color. I think that's some of it. Of course, though, there is a really great seminal piece by Yatasha Womack that's called Afrofuturism. It actually starts to encompass all of those pieces. And I actually just submitted a syllabus to UCR for Intro to Afrofuturism and Visual Culture class. So I think those discussions are still happening. But Black speculative arts, you know, I think, or, right. The Black speculative arts movement is something I think is actually a little bit more encompassing. But that's not to say that Afrofuturism is dead or it's like it's not being talked about. I think it still is. I think that we're just coming up with different variations and maybe like mutations of it now. Yeah.
What do we need to do to help your griots and your storytellers and our scholars? And what do we need to fund and protect and build to help you put out our culture to heal the toxicity in all the country, cultures of this world? Because that's all I need to know.
Right.
Nice. You want
to
take that?
So what can we do to?
That was a lot, brother.
That was a lot. I'm trying to summarize. You know. So what can you all do to help support the writers?
What do we make sure the culture and the things that wealth creates something non-toxic that we pass on, not just to our children, but our people in the communities? Because, you know, these other things are going to get dealt with. Mm-hmm. Trust me, my family still owns the land of plantations, only military since the Civil War. It's going to get dealt with.
So, you know, this is a great event in terms of an example of what all of us can do in supporting the artists, young artists, new artists. If you, like, I came into comics through, like, the mainstream, you know, and Marvel and that kind of thing. But digging deeper than that and finding the creators, number one. If you're a producer with money, I think really one of the big realms right now is film. That's the hardest hurdle to get past. You can throw a web series on YouTube for a little less money, but a cheap film is $30 million, you know, very often. So that kind of money is very hard. I can speak from experience. I have had people trying to make films for my books since I started publishing in 1995, some closer than others. And the independent guys are usually shut out of the conversation. So then you're at the studio where people are literally asking you, do the characters have to be black? When you wonder why they aren't black, that's why they're not black, because of that conversation right there. Now, it's changing. It's changing, and I think we're in a situation now where black filmmakers can lead and are leading, like you mentioned Array and Ava DuVernay. But I've been to, like, say, the Bronze Lens Film Festival in Atlanta, the Pan-African Film Festival in LA, in a room just like this where a producer will stand up and say, hey, I want to fund a film, come pitch me your idea. And it's a meeting of a creator and a funder, and boom, you know, I stood in line too, but she said, oh, we don't do horror, and that was the end of that. But you never know, right? So it's... It really is a matter of creating venues where people can meet and network and just make it happen. Mm-hmm. That is the bottom line. And film festivals are a good way to do that, but they don't necessarily draw you folks, right? Because you haven't made a movie. So it's creating that space.
Let's definitely talk about that, though. Yes. We have time for one more question before we have to break.
Some academic connections, and I'm a scholar who is working on Afro-surrealism, and I find that my dissertation is kind of being pushed maybe a certain way because I'm being encouraged to focus on the more European elements, and I'm wondering how do you actually, when you're writing about Afrofuturism or Afro-surrealism, how do you convince an academic institutions that are still majority white, that you're not writing about the Italian futurists, or you're not writing about the European tradition, even though you may have some connections or conversations or cross-pollination with these things? How do you kind of claim that what you're doing and is just what you're doing? It's your own.
Yeah, I think you push back. You start with spaces like Sherry Renee Thomas's Dark Matter. You look at quite recently, the Black Speculative Arts Manifesto by Rinaldo Anderson, and there the two books coming out, Afrofuturism 2.0, the Black Speculative Arts Movement. There's a great deal of scholarship around now that actually I think is proof positive that can show that these particular narratives are not being generated from the spaces that they're trying to kind of project upon your work, right? I also think that. We need to come together and actually find mentorship between each other to actually pull it together. So let's have a conversation about that, because there's a great deal of scholarship out there, a great deal of like really powerful scholars at various universities around the world, actually, as Tananarive was stating, that will have your back on things like that. So,
but it's a battle,
it
you
is.
Know, and you've asked a mouthful there. I've been blessed. I was at Spelman where the department head, Dr. Tarsha Stanley, was the president of the Octavia Butler Society. So I didn't have to explain anything to her, you know. And at UCLA also, again, blessed. That African American Studies department is really into it. And but it's not always the case, as you know.
I would also say, like, if you have the option, try to get people on your committee that are going to ride for you right here. So, because you always need at least one person who's going to be in your corner, mm-hmm. who can advocate for you. So, if you get to put your committee together with like at least one person from outside of your school, then that's helpful.
All right. Well, thank you. This is wonderful.
Right. Thank you.
Thank you for having us.
Seriously.
Great conversation.